So that they will also get refreshed in their memory what they heard it, and you will also be able to learn from them. So we will be able to practice what we have heard. Okay. And My name is Abraham, David, John, in the right sequence. Father Abraham, King the David, John the Apostle, not the Baptist. I don't want to be beheaded, okay? And I come from London and I live there. I have a wife and two boys, and more than the boys, they are the men. My son, the elder one, is 26, the younger one is 22, and I do business, and also I pastor a church called World Christian Fellowship, and our core call is to build and plant churches, and so far God has enabled us to plant about 15 churches across the world, even in the US, also in Europe and other places. We have about four Latvian language speaking churches, two in UK, three in UK, and five of them, two in Latvia. We recently opened one more this January, so five Latvian speaking churches, and also we have enabled some of Russian speaking churches in Russia as well. And if you want to know anything more about us, you can go to wcoflondon.com. That website will give you more details, or you Google my name. We are all Google generation, so you'll be able to get it. That's a bit of introduction, because every time I meet somebody, they always ask me, so I thought maybe I don't like to be introduced. And you know, one time I went to a conference in Lagos in Nigeria to speak to a pastor. So the guy who went to introduce me, he spoke about 10 minutes about me. So he was saying so much about me, so I myself want to meet myself, so much he gave. I went to another place, he said, this guy was where he wanted to be very humble, so he said, you know, we have a speaker whose name is so-and-so, and he has come from London, and you know, by the way, you know, God used a donkey to speak, so he can use anybody. So I thought, okay, so it's better that let me introduce myself, so no need for anybody to introduce me, not that way, this way. So I know I am a child of God, so I'm very happy with that, okay? So today we are going to look at the second session. So let's close our eyes for a moment and let's look to God. Lord, in the name of Jesus Christ, we come before your throne of grace. Lord, we bring all our thoughts, we bring everything. There are maybe some of them have come this morning, some of us had a good night's sleep, some of them didn't have, but maybe there are some compelling issues, maybe there are some health issues, there are some questions about the future, there may be, you know, many number of things may be pressing us. But this time, we set aside everything and we want to focus our attention to listen to you. As your word says, we have everything what we need for our life and godliness in the knowledge of your Son Jesus Christ. So we pray, speak to us. Here we are, ready to listen to you. In Jesus' name. Amen. The open mind. The Bible never advocates us to put our brains in the drawers and come to church without brains. It's nothing wrong in asking questions. You should ask questions. Because God has given us one of the amazing and a powerful to a human being is our soul or the mind. People don't realize our faith is not a blind faith. We have got such a reason and an established one in the Word of God why we believe what we believe. Because if you don't use your brains, if you don't use your soul, you will not be able to live a good Christian life. As Proverbs 23:7 says, whosoever thinketh, so he will be. So our battle is not in the world, our battle is not anywhere, our battle is in between your ears. The greatest battle what you have got is in between your ears. Nowhere else. Because if we don't renew our mind with the word of God, we will not have a mind like Christ. Let me quickly, you know, build the foundation so that you understand how, what a powerful soul we have got. In Genesis 1:26, God said, let's make man in our own image. So we are made like God. In John 4:24, it says, God is spirit. So you and me are a spiritual being going through this human experience. It's not we are human going through a spiritual experience. Please get this clear. I am a spiritual being going through this human experience so that I will be able to live my this physical life which will glorify God and I will be with Him for eternity. So my task here is to live my physical life in a glorifying way to the God who sent us. Because we are three beings. As 1 Thessalonians 5:23 says, we are a spirit, soul and body. We hear the voice of our body very well. I'm hungry. My legs are paining. I'm feeling sleepy. You know, all the time we hear the sound of our body very clearly because that is the one we look after so well. Whatever you feed, that will be your dominant voice in your life. Because we make sure that we eat three times. Sometimes we eat more. Maybe four times or five times. I used to live in Indonesia and also in Malaysia and Singapore, you know. There people eat five or six meals. Small quantity, not like us, you know. Put sambar, then rasam, then puli kolambu, then more, all those things. And then again, to digest, we eat with rasam again, you know. Because the more and more we are feeding our physical body, the physical voice is so much louder. And what happens is, since we are three being, whatever the dominant voice, that will be overheard very well. But then, when three people are there, the casting vote is done by your soul. Your casting vote is done by your soul. If your mind is not renewed and if you don't have an open mind, then you will not be able to live your life which is pleasing to God. Because when the casting vote comes, let me bring it down to practically so that you understand much better. Say for example, you keep a morning alarm at 5 o'clock. Though we have come to a retreat, so I want to take some time to listen to the Lord, so let me keep the alarm at 5 o'clock. So you keep the alarm at morning 5 o'clock, and then as soon as the alarm goes at 5 o'clock, what is the first thought comes? Snooze it. But then deep within you, there is a craving of the spirit voice. No, I want to be with the Lord. But then the dominant voice is, you are so tired. See, your back is paining. This is, you know, your leg is paining. Sleep for some more time. That's the voice of your body. But then the casting vote comes from your mind. The casting vote comes from your mind. Then your mind says, you spent about 15 minutes in the toilet. Today, you spend 5 minutes less in the toilet. So sleep for 5 more minutes. That's a casting vote comes from your mind. So what do? Okay, let me sleep for 5 more minutes. So when you wake up, what is the time? 7:30. But your mind is renewed, what immediately the mind voice will say, get up now. Because one who searches the Lord in the morning, he will find him. And my everything I need, it is in the Lord. So I need to go to him. Then the casting vote, it always comes from your mind. The human reasoning is the unrenewed mind voice. The human reasoning is the voice of the unrenewed mind. Let me give you another example. You've been praying or you've been looking to buy the latest gadgets. What is that? iPhone or maybe Samsung, whatever, the latest phone. Okay, iPhone 10 or 11, whatever the latest one has come that you wanted to buy. And you come. And after I go back, maybe I'm spending so many dollars here, when I go back, I use money and then I'll buy the phone. So when you come, you park the car, when you get out, immediately on next to your car, you find the brand new phone, what you have prayed, what you have been dreamt, or what you had a vision, it is there. Immediately, what does that happens? You want to take it. As soon as you take it, you are feeling so good in your body. But then there is a voice comes inside of you that someone else's. Immediately you will hear another voice which comes from your mind. Two ways. One is, check is there anybody is watching. Is there a CCTV camera? Is there anybody else is watching? But if you have a renewed mind, immediately you say, I have to go and give it to the lost and found because this does not belong to me. Do not covet. That's what the Bible says. You see, always there are everything which comes into your mind, good and the bad, and if your mind is renewed, then you will act upon the word of God and your ways will be pleased in the Lord. If it's unrenewed, then it will work against God. So before coming into the open mind, you need to know that your mind has got to be renewed. The unrenewed mind is demonic in nature. It is sensual. James 3:15 very clearly says, the unrenewed mind is demonic. Hello? I didn't call that. The Bible calls it. If you have not renewed your mind with the word of God, then you are demonic in nature. Because there is nothing good dwells in us. There's absolutely nothing good dwells in us. There's no way that nobody can go and stand before God and say that, God, I deserve a place with you because I am good. Just for a moment, you're all looking very holy, very serious, very nice. Thank God for it. But if only I can run what is running in your mind on the screen, how many of you will be able to sit here? Everybody come, let's all sit together. Let's watch what is running your mind today. Let's call the congregation, gather together. Okay, let's watch it today. Pastor Abraham's mind. That's it. I have to run miles and millions of miles away. Because there is nothing good else in this. What happens is, I have to renew my mind with the word of God. Then only I will be able to understand and I will be able to discern what is right and what is wrong, what is pleasing to God, what is not pleasing to God. So the first and foremost, we need to renew our mind. Then only you will be able to understand that how to have a openness in our mind to embrace other people. Because Apostle Paul writes to the church in Corinth. Corinth is one of the most corrupt church you could find at that point in time. To them he writes, he goes on to the list about born again on the spirit, carnal mind and a natural mind. He goes through the list in chapter 2 and then finally he ends with, but we have the mind of Christ. The reason is, if we don't have that kind of a mind, then we will not have a openness. So have this as a basic and a foundation, you know, because this definitely you would have heard from the message from Romans chapter 12 verse 1 and 2, that by renewing your minds you will know what is the good and the pleasing and the perfect will of God. So I'm sure about it, so that's why I'm not going into that. But if you have that renewed mind, then you will be able to have the openness in your mind to embrace what God wants you to do. So turn with me to Mark chapter 5. The Gospel according to Mark chapter 5. You can go at your leisure, you can read the whole chapter, but I'm going to read few verses. Mark chapter 5, verse 3. You will find it after Matthew. There are some people still searching the Bible. Okay? Follow along with me. Who had his dwelling, this is the demon-possessed man, he had his dwelling among the tombs, and no one could bind him, not even with chains. Because he had often been bound with shackles and chains, and the chains had been pulled apart by him, and the shackles broken in pieces, neither could anyone tame him. And always, night and day, he was in the mountains and in the tombs, crying out, cutting himself with stones. This is the description about the demon-possessed man who was walking around, running around in this village, naked, cutting himself, throwing stones, and going through a havoc in that city and living in the tombs. If you see a person like that, what would be your response first? Tell me. Come on, help me to preach. What would you do when you see a person? He's running naked, okay? He's throwing stones. Nobody could bind him. His shackles are broken. He breaks the chain. He's in the tomb and he's in the mountains and he's running around. Certainly he would have had a long hair and dirty things and everything. What would you do when you look at him? Stay away. Okay. Hi. Okay. That's a good one. Run away. There's a very good saying in Tamil. Tushanakanda. You come that side, I'm going that side, okay? I don't want even pass by. I said, the unrenewed mind is demonic in nature. Maybe he wasn't clothed physically. But we were also once under the influence of demons. When we came to know the Lord, then we have been delivered. When we sang a song, when the Son of Man sets you free, you are free indeed. So we have been set free. But do we look at how God looks at that person? You know what? You will talk to someone whom you feel very comfortable. Even though you are a Christian, even though you are a very good Christian, you come to church regularly, you pray, you give your money, you are so faithful and everything, yet you don't go the extra step to become like Christ. Yes. If someone comes to you with the shabby clothes to your church, do you go and hug him? Do you go and say, "Hello, brother, so good to see you. I am so glad you came to the church. We are the church of Jesus Christ. We want to show you the love of God. Come, brother. Bro, come, I'll take you for a haircut. I'll cut your hair and I will get it washed and I will buy you some new clothes." Is that what you do? Or you come to, "Who's that guy? New, watch out. He may pick up that or this and go, okay, huh? I'm watching. I'm looking." How do we respond? A new stranger, someone who's in a lowly state, who comes to your church, how do you welcome him? Will he feel that I can sense the love and the presence of God in this place? Maybe you are an IT guy, you are earning so much of money, you are working for a big corporate company or a big organization, and you know, and you are dressed up very well and you are walking in. Yeah, everybody likes to, "Oh, okay, where? Oh, he's the CEO. Oh, okay, he works for this bank. Oh, he's the VP for this one. Oh, okay. Oh, brother, you know that guy is a VP. Yeah, okay." That's fine. But do you embrace the lowly people? You know, we hear about the story about wise men in our Bible. How many wise men? There's no three. Okay, we all may think it is three. The Bible never says it's three wise men. Okay, the wise men. Because Sunday's class drama, we always use three, so we always say three wise men. And the song also three wise men. There is nothing is mentioned. The wise men were so foolish, you know that. The wise men were so foolish. Let me tell you, there was a sign given to the shepherds. You see the star, you follow the star, it will lead you to the Messiah. The shepherds looked at the star, they walked, they reached the baby Jesus. The wise man looked at the star, came up to Jerusalem. Now we know where the king is born. Go to the palace. Go to Herod. "I am wise, bro. I know where will be the king born. The star has come up to Jerusalem. That's more than enough for us. We know. Now we can figure it out." So they went to the palace. They were with Herod. The Bible scholars and everything, they predict maybe it was when they came and met Jesus. Jesus must have been about a couple of years old. The simple were able to understand, the wise could not. If you are being wise in your own sense, then this is what happens. So how are you doing? Forget about church. In your own neighborhood or in your own office, if somebody troubles you in your office, do you see him, he is the potential to accept the Lord Jesus Christ, or are you wanting to get rid of him? Now some people come and tell me, "Anna, I got such a irritating boss. Please pray that I will get a transfer. I want to shift my department." 3 months you pray, nothing happens. Then you come back, what happened? "Anna, still the same." Okay, next 3 months you pray that he will be transferred. Nothing happens. Because God has placed you for a purpose. Because anyone whom you meet, either in your home or in your neighborhood or in your flat where you are staying or in your on the street, wherever you meet with someone, whoever come into your path, can they see Christ in you? Or you, can you be the Christ for them? Because you are called Christians. Why you are called Christians? Because Christ is in you. That's why you are being called Christians. Not because you wear a cross, or not because you carry a Bible, or because you put a fish sticker on your car. That doesn't make a Christian. If you think that will make a Christian, there's one guy who came so close to Jesus, he was with Jesus for 3 years, and he even hugged him and kissed him, yet he went to a different direction. How are you doing in that? I can give you scores of examples of how every church of what we have planted have come into existence. Somebody goes, let me give you one good example. There is a girl who lives in Malaysia, and her brother, their father passed away. They were going to a good nominal Christian church. They were living up a Christian life, but then they were so disappointed, they were so disillusioned, they left church, they left everything, they were staying at home. In spite of experiencing the love of God and everything, they were so disappointed how the loving God can take away our father. They were not going to church for 3 years. And once she stumbled into one of our messages, she started listening to my messages, and then when she heard the message, then she had come back to faith, and then she wrote to me, I wrote to her, then we started established contact. Then she said, I understand the purpose behind why what we went through, but now I want to reach out, what can I do? I said, is your brother has come into faith? She said, yes, now he has also come into faith. So they both started going to the church, and they wanted to do something for the Lord. And then she asked me, what can I do? I said, okay, do you have some relatives? She said, I have got plenty of them. I said, okay, here is the thing. You call everyone home, feed them, sing a couple of songs, and you tell why you believe the Lord Jesus Christ. And then if you can't speak, then play one of the messages. She called, 35 of the relatives came, and they sang two songs, brother and sisters. And then they said, I want to share something, but before that I have got a pastor who guides me. He lives in London, and I want to show one of the message, so you can listen to this message. She played it on the television. About 25 to 35 of them, they sat and they watched. And then finally she said, okay, next week we want to pray, whoever want to pray, I will pray. So she made a simple prayer, and then she said, next Saturday we are going to do, how many of you are willing to come? 17 of them said they will come. All of them are non-Christians. 17 of them that they will come. The next week 17 came. Week after, the 17 went and brought their friends. About 50 people came the week after. And now there are about 60 people are coming to their home every Saturday. And almost about 30 or 31 people have been baptized so far. What is stopping you? Why you cannot see there's a potential opportunity wherever God has placed you? Pastor, I can't speak like you. I don't remember the verse. You don't have to remember any verse. Hello? You know about yourself, how you were when Jesus came, what he had done to you, and who you are now. That nobody can dispute your life. If you talk about the baptism, there are many opinions. You talk about the Holy Spirit, there are so many expositions, there are so many disputes. But that is one thing nobody can dispute, is your life testimony. I always train my people, 2 minutes testimony, 5 minutes, 15 minutes testimony. 3, you have to. If you are meeting somebody on the train or a bus, 2 minutes testimony. If you are standing or waiting for something, 5 minutes testimony. If you have targeted that person, then 15 minutes testimony, call them home, give them food. As soon as they keep their finger on their food, start your testimony. They can never escape. 15 minutes, they have to sit and listen to you. You share your testimony. And you say, do you want me to pray for you? I haven't come across anyone who said, no, don't pray for me. Not even one person. I'm telling you. There's hardly anyone who sat next to me in the plane with me. I've not heard my testimony or I've let them go just like that. Never. There are so many people who have come to know the Lord by traveling next to me. What's the problem? You know, now what we have brought it down is, if you put a Facebook update, I am a Christian, you think you have done a big thing, service for God. If I put one verse, brother, I did something for the Lord, I put a verse on the Facebook. Now sometimes I feel like, you know, tongue. Think for a moment. This guy has got such a big problem. He has about 2,000 demons. Yet he could not control himself coming and bow down at the feet of Jesus Christ. And Jesus gives him one massive discount and get rid of him, all the demons at one go. I want you to look at verse 15. You know these narratives and the stories. Verse 15. Then they came to Jesus. The villagers heard about this, and also they heard about what happened to the pigs. So they came to Jesus and saw the one who had been demon possessed and heard the legion, sitting, clothed, and in his right mind, and they were rejoicing. And they were afraid. You see, in your area, if someone is running around naked and suddenly he is being delivered, what should be your reaction? Wow! How come this has happened? No! It didn't happen that way. They are afraid now. They don't want to touch him when he was running around naked also. They don't want to come to him when he is clothed in right mind also. This is exactly like many of our Christian circle. We don't want to go and reach out to the sinners. And we don't want to go and do something whom we have to share the gospel also. But we are very happy with what we are. Pastor, we will sing 3 songs. And then 1 psalm we will read. Then the 4th song. Then we will take the offering. Then 20 minutes preaching. After that you finish. This is all you need to do. In America there are many churches are run by board. The board tells what the pastor should do. There are some churches, the pastor tells everything what the board should do. Both are extreme. Both are extreme. I'm traveling, I'm talking to many, many big churches, small churches, few home groups. I'm going around, I know exactly what is happening in this country. We don't want you to offend this guy. We don't want you to talk on this one. You talk about this one. You know, interestingly, every church member knows what the pastor should know, except the pastor. Hello? Yeah? Every one of them know what the pastor should do, what the pastor should preach on, how he should preach on, how he has to bring up his children, how he has to bring up his wife, all those things. You have got every opinion on that. That's fair enough. That's very good. But do you obey? Do you have that mind like this? Jesus delivered this guy and he is in right mind. Now they are scared to come to him. Just for a moment, you come back to this village setting, what would be your reaction? If you were one among the ordinary person, what should be your reaction? Let's talk about it. What would you be doing? If you see him, he is sitting next to Jesus and Jesus is talking and he is sitting next, clothed, right mind and everything, he is sitting. What would you do? Would you approach him? Let's, you know, we read about this, we preach about it. Let's put ourselves into this story. This has really happened. This is a real story. It's not a imaginary story or anything. It's a real thing. It's a real incident happened. Recently, I think in 1980s, they excavated one church. And the church was built by this man. The guy who was delivered of demon process, they excavated a church. Because when he wanted to go along with Jesus, you'll see this interestingly. In verse 18, when Jesus got into the boat, the demon possessed man who had been demon possessed begged him that he might be with Jesus. However, Jesus did not permit him, but said to him, "Go home to your friends and tell them what great things the Lord has done for you and how he had compassion on you." This guy got only one sermon. Hello? This guy got only one sermon. He doesn't have any theology. He doesn't have any, you know, immersion baptism or the Holy Spirit in you or the overflow or none of those things or any of those things. All he has got is only one sermon. Nothing else. Imagine what he can preach, he can go and preach. Hey, you know the guy who was running around naked? Yeah, we know. He was cutting and he was lying in the, you know, tomb and he was like living in the cemetery. Yeah, I know. Yeah. We heard about this guy. That guy is no longer being seen in the Makkah. That's me. Oh. Yeah. I was like this. Jesus came. He delivered me. And if you want, come to Jesus. He will deliver you. That's all his message. And he was able to build a church in his village after that. Don't you think you and me are more qualified or more equipped to do more than this demon-possessed man? It is so nice to hear. I really appreciate this story, but still I can't do, brother. You don't know my situation. You don't know my neighborhood. You don't know my company. You don't know the trouble my manager gives. Stop giving excuse. Stop giving excuse. Start looking how Jesus is looked at the circumstances. Wherever you are, you have to look and you have to see in your spiritual eyes what God wants you to do so that you will be able to see beyond the limitations what you see. Because if demon possessed man, no, I don't want to touch it. Oh, he's running naked, no, not me. To our Latvian church in Warrington, there was a guy in his 37 years old guy who came to our church in one of our services. This guy has been addicted to drugs from 17 years old. For 20 long years he was addicted to drugs. He walked into our church and God touched him and delivered him. Same day, he he dropped the drugs. He completely released and he was restored. He started coming to the church and he got married and he was serving in the church. Tuck, tuck, very quick progression. Service morning till night, he will not do anything. He will do only the church activity. He will go bring people, pick up, doing all those things. And he was so full of joy and energy and he wanted to do. So I went to a New Year service on 2016 and I gave them a challenge. This year, from this church, you have to give birth to another church. So I want to invite you who are all can go and do the thing. This guy stood up and he said, I will go, Pastor. I will go and do. Okay, fair enough, good. Let's pray. We prayed. He said, Pastor, I will go to Coventry. Coventry is a place, there are so many Latvians. I see there are a lot of drug addicted people. I wanted to go. Okay, go. Started the service in Coventry. I went for the church inauguration service. After 6 months, he called me. He said, Pastor, we want you to come. There is a baptism service. There are 11 people who have been delivered of drugs. They want to take baptism. I want you to come. I went there. I couldn't get in the baptist. I was crying like a baby. A drug addicted guy. He went and looked for the people, those who are in that. And he shared the love of God. And he has brought 11 people into the Lord. I said, you have to give baptism, not me. He said, no, Pastor, I want you to do it. I said, unless you come, I won't come inside. My church, my brother, my sister, it's not a sing song we come here. You took my place. You bore my sin. I've been set free. What are you doing with your freedom? What are you doing? Is God is going to do something with your money? Do you think so? God has everything. He owns all. He has no need of gold. He has no need of silver. He has no need of building. He has no need of anything. All he needs is, he is looking for his people. He wants to save his people. He wants to have his children. That's why you and me have been sent here. When Jesus breathed on to the disciples in John 20:21, he said, as the Father has sent me, so I send you. It's the same mandate what God has given to Jesus is being passed on to us. So you and me cannot be at the complacence. Yeah, I'm fine. I'm coming to church. I'm doing this worship, or I'm doing this one. I'm doing that one. It's enough, Pastor. That's all I can do. No. When you go to be meet with God, what are you going to take it with him? When you get to heaven, what is that you are going to say? Lord, every Sunday I went to church. I gave offering. I prayed. That's all I could do. That's that what you can? There's a lady who lives in Sweden. She's 76 years old. She could not go anywhere because her legs were damaged. She can't walk. All she can do is she has learned to use the computer. She started listening our messages. She said, I have to do something. In one of the messages, I shared about a blind woman. Let me tell you that story so that you will understand. There was an old lady who was blind, and one day somebody shared the gospel to her and she had received the Lord Jesus Christ she was 76 year old, she couldn't do anything. She was thinking, oh Lord, I've lost my whole of my life, I have to do something. What can I do? I'm so old, I can't go and I can't do this thing, I can't even read, what can I do? So she went to the nearby church and she said, Aya, would you give me some kind of a leaflet which will talk about the love of God and people will understand. She said, yes, they gave a leaflet. She walked down to the bus station. Every day she will come to one different bus stop. Morning till evening she will sit at the bus stop. Anyone who goes this side and that side, she will say, Thambi, Tangachi, can you please help me? I need one help. They ask, what is that? I can't read, Thambi. I just can't read. I'm so old. Nobody is there for me. I'm all alone. Will you please help me to read this? Can you please read it this for me? It talks about the whole gospel. And finally, the sinner's prayer. In 6 months, she was able to lead over 70 people to the Lord. A blind, uneducated, untrained, no qualification, nothing, but she was able to do it. Why? Because she felt the need. She saw, it's God has saved me. There are so many people are perishing. I can't be like this. I just can't sit like this. Because I have experienced His love. How can I be quiet? How can I be? What way I can reach out to them? How they will be able to see the love of God? How they will be coming to the experience of the knowledge of God so that they can also come into the kingdom? Because it's not an exclusive club. Church, Jesus did not die for Christians. Jesus died for everyone. But it is our responsibility to pass it on. How are we going to do that? Have an open mind. See what God is asking you to do today. You have been placed in New York, New Jersey, and all the suburbs. You are the light. You are the salt. And how can you reach out? It's all good to have our all Indian people. Yeah, very good. Because we all have got so much of common things. Absolutely fine. We are allowed to eat. Very fine. No problem. Any Indian gathering, we eat. We make sure we eat and eat and eat and eat. I was joking yesterday with the pastor. When we talk about fasting prayer in a church, immediately the first question comes is, what are we going to eat after the fasting prayer? The theme and everything is forgotten. First is, you tell me what we will eat. Okay, last time that sister made biryani, that wasn't good. This time we will order from Pavachi, or we will order from, you know, this one or that one. You know, all those things only comes, not about this one. What are we going to do? Why God has placed you here? Why God has got this church? Why you are being part of this church, and how this church can give birth to others, and how this church can equip you, and the church can send you out, how you can go and bring more people into the kingdom. How? Because as you, if you don't have that kind of a oneness, if you don't have the one mind, then it is impossible. Quickly, let me, before we go on to a group discussion, let me share one more thing. Turn with me to Acts chapter 12. You know, because churches gather together and pray, but then you see how they pray. Verse 4, and when he, that Herod, had arrested Peter, he put him in prison and delivered him to four squads of soldiers to keep him. intending to bring him before the people after Passover. Peter was therefore kept in prison, but constant prayer was offered to God for him by the church. Okay? Here is the situation. Peter was arrested and he is in prison, and Herod is going to bring him on the unleavened bread day, and he is going to behead him. The church is praying together. Okay, are you with me? So let's localize it. Kamalesh has been arrested for speaking against some of the sins of the society, and he is in the prison. You church, very good church, you all gather together and you are all praying for him. Okay? Some of you are saying, no, Pastor, I won't pray. No, you are all good people. I know you all pray for your pastor. Praise the Lord. So you are praying. So the same way, the church in Jerusalem got together and they are praying. Peter is sleeping in the prison. I always wonder, when somebody says something about you, you couldn't sleep. You don't even know, is it true or not? Somebody comes and tells you, so-and-so told, so-and-so, and I heard it. That's enough for you. You will have a sleepless night. How can she say that? Ennaga neenga eppadi thoongureenga? You don't even bother about me. You don't care about me. That person has told so-and-so, no. So whole of week you will be fuming, fuming until you come next Sunday. Praise the Lord. Little bit I have made it right, like, you know, I'll turn and go. That means I am angry with you, okay? I showed it to you. So we can't sleep. This guy is going to be beheaded next day. He's sleeping so sound. The angel comes inside. The angel has to literally kick him to wake him up. Literally. They has to wake him up and then has to put him a dress. So the angel brings him first gate, second gate, third gate, and brought him out. Go home and read the whole chapter. And then he comes to John Mark's house. There is a prayer meeting happening in Jerusalem in John Mark's house. And Peter comes and knocks at the door. The servant girl Rhoda comes down and opens the door. Well, not opens the door. She finds out, who's that? I'm Peter. She's so joyful. She goes up, stop praying. We have Peter at the door. Immediately all the people, what did they say? Praise the Lord, our prayer has been answered. No. You crazy. You fool. You know, crazy. You know, Russian strana, you know. You are Allah kalandrichi. We are praying for Peter release, but we are not expecting Peter. Hello? We are praying for Peter. Okay? We all gathered here. Why? Peter to be released. But then we are not expecting Peter. Immediately one guy gives an exposition. That must be angel of Peter. Because he has studied some Bible. Maybe he went to Bible college or something. That must be the angel of Peter. But it can't be Peter. We only pray for the release of Peter, but we don't expect him to come. You know why? Read verse 1 and 2. Now about the time Herod the king stretched out his hand to harass some from the church, then he killed James, the brother of John, with the sword. Same thing happened for James. We prayed for James, but we received two parts. Head separate, body separate. So now they arrested Peter. So we are praying, but we are not expecting one Peter. We are expecting two. Head separate, body separate. Last time in our prayer, that's what we got the reply. And today, this time also, we are praying that way. My church, If you don't have that openness in heart to hear what God is doing, then you will be praying a meaningless prayer. You will believe something else, but in your mouth you will be saying, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. There are many people who ask me to come, ask the children, they will bring the children, Pastor, pray for my son. He doesn't do very well in maths. He is so bad in maths. And then you pray. After that, even maths ay varadu Pastor. Then how, why do you pray? Before prayer also you say he can't do maths. After prayer also you say you can't pray maths. Then why you have to pray? Just a religious activity I have to do now. My husband, he doesn't know anything, Pastor. All the time he goes and gives commitment to somebody or he loses money. I've told him many times, he is like that only. Anyhow, you pray, Pastor. When somebody comes and tells me, I said, it's okay, brother, sister, you said it, it will happen according to your faith, it will happen, go. What's the point? No, because you are not expecting him to be changed. Do you see, what do you see about your church? What do you see the future of your church? What do you see? How do you see? What is the next level, what you are thinking of this church can do? I'm not talking about the building. I'm not talking about this one. I'm talking about the people as a corporate body. How this body is going to move forward, how this body is going to glorify God. Can you have an open mind what the Lord speaks to you? I'm not saying your pastor is the perfect guy. Neither do I, or nor you. None of us are perfect. We are all work in progress. But we have been called to do certain things, so we are called doing, and that's what Kamalesh is doing among yourself. He may not preach like me, I may not be able to preach like him. We are so different. But God has kept you as a leader to guide you. And how can you see as a church, as a corporate body, how can you have an open mind that God, where God wants us to go from here to there? What is our next step? How we can go as a body, how we can grow together? We are knit together, we can progress further together. A human body consists of 206 bones. In Ezekiel 37, we read about the dry bones. The bones all over, it's like a pile of bones. Then God says, let it come through. All the 206 bones came together in order, in sequence, in the right place. Hello? You should know what kind of a place God has given you in the body you are in. There may be some, maybe thigh bone, but if you want to be a neck, then how will the body will look? Think for a moment. In the body, how many mouths is there? Then what a tough question, huh? You're all thinking so much. How many mouth is there? Only one. Maybe you are thinking, if I had two, then it would have been easy, Pastor. One from the front, one from the back. I could have been communicating to both the people. So everything God, you know, there are so many analogy or the comparison for the church. One is body. Christ is the head. We are the body. So we have to work together, we have to come together, for which what we need to understand is that you are a part of this body and you should know what is your part, then you will have with the right open mind for what God can do. So what we are going to do is for the next 20 minutes or 15 to 20 minutes, what we are going to do is we are going to gather together as a group according to the color. Maybe like yesterday, what was the green came to the side. Okay, green can come to this end. And I don't want pastor to be group representative. Also, Sumitra should not be a representative. Others should be the representative for the respective group. Come on, quickly, so that, you know, 12 o'clock is lunch. So.